Hollywood is more than just a sun-drenched city in Southern California. It's a magical institution, a place that manufactures fantastic dreams on an assembly line basis. For nearly 100 years now, it's broadcast its siren call to the masses. Come, be a film star, dance and sing. Come and get rich and famous. And thousands have come, and among the many, a lucky few have found a glittering paradise on earth. But what price do some pay? And what evil do some commit to stake their claim in paradise? Virginia Rappe. She was born in New York in 1895 and died in California in 1921. Not much is known about her early life, except that she worked as an artist's model when she was 16. Then she came to Hollywood to become a film star. She struggled for several years and landed a few minor parts in films now long forgotten. At age 26, she became the most famous actress in the world. But she had to die to get that famous. Brutally murdered, screamed William Randolph Hearst's San Francisco Examiner. And there were plenty of lurid details and assumptions as to how this poor starlet met her fate. According to a witness, she was raped and murdered by Roscoe Fatty Arbuckle, one of Hollywood's top silent film stars. It happened in San Francisco, here at the St. Francis Hotel on Labor Day, September 5th, 1921. Fatty had come to party after finishing 9 movies and working himself to near exhaustion. In his 12th floor suite, in rooms 1219, 1220, and 1221, the Victrola blared, and in spite of prohibition, the whiskey flowed for Fatty and his friends. Virginia Rappe and a dress model by the name of Bambina Maud Delmont crashed the party. What happened to Virginia next, and what didn't happen to her, was to become the focus of 3 murder trials. Fatty, it was reported, found her vomiting on the bathroom floor. He claimed he picked her up and put her on a bed and then left the hotel with a friend for some sightseeing. Everyone assumed that her problem was simply too much alcohol. But 4 days later, after finally being taken to the hospital, Virginia Rappe died. Cause of death was determined to be peritonitis, internal injuries related to bladder dysfunction. Bambina Maud Delmont, Virginia's companion at the party, spread the rumor that the 300-pound Arbuckle had brutally raped and crushed Virginia. Inflammatory coverage in William Randolph Hearst's newspaper fueled public opinion into outrage. Hearst boasted that the Arbuckle story sold more papers than the sinking of the Lusitania. Roscoe Fatty Arbuckle was arrested and charged with murder. In the first trial, the judge considered the prosecution's case so weak that he reduced the charge of murder to manslaughter, especially since Bambina Maud Delmont's conflicting stories began to fall apart. The California police had previously filed 50 counts of extortion, bigamy, fraud, and racketeering against Delmont, who at times was known as Madam Black. The jury deadlocked 10-2 for Fatty's acquittal. In a second trial, the prosecution came closer. The jury deadlocked at 10-2 to convict. In yet a third trial, Arbuckle was finally acquitted and freed. The jury exonerated him completely, stating that there was little evidence that he had anything to do whatsoever with Rappe's death. The jury even apologized to him. But Arbuckle's career was ruined. For 10 years, he struggled to make a comeback, but the public and much of Hollywood would have none of him. His last picture, Gasoline Gus, was pulled from Grauman's Chinese Theater. In 1933, he died of heart failure at the age of 46. He was cremated, and his ashes were scattered on the Pacific Ocean. Buster Keaton, his longtime friend, firmly believed that he had died from a broken heart. So, to many people's minds, if Virginia Rappe was murdered, it was after her death by yellow journalism and a lynch mob public. Before the third trial of Fatty Arbuckle got underway, this man was found dead on his living room floor with a .38 caliber slug in his back. As near as could be determined, the shot was fired at about 9 o'clock on the evening of February 1, 1922. At the time of his death, he lived at this location on Alvarado Street, which used to be luxury apartments in an exclusive neighborhood. He was a top motion picture director, described by those who knew him as an idealist, a gentleman, and very well liked, except, obviously, for the one who murdered him. He was born in Ireland as William Cunningham Dean Tanner, lived in New York till the age of 36, then came to Hollywood. He changed his name to William Desmond Taylor and became an actor. And very quickly, he became a director. He directed such stars as Mary Pickford, Douglas Fairbanks, and Mary Miles Minter. Taylor was on top of the world. So how did it come to this? Who murdered him? And what was his or her motive? The single bullet that killed Taylor came from a .38 caliber gun. A neighbor heard the shot, but assumed that it was the backfire of a passing motor car. His valet, Henry Peavy, discovered his body in the early morning hours of the following day. Before long, the police, and especially the press, had compiled a list of suspects as varied and as intriguing as any murder mystery movie. Among them was the beautiful Mary Miles Minter, 22, who many believed was the next Mary Pickford. Taylor had directed her, and she was in love with him. She wrote him love letters. But he never gave in to her sexual advances. Was Mary a woman scorned, as in hell knows no fury? Then there was Mary's overly protective stage mother, Charlotte Shelby. She was afraid that her daughter would be compromised and her career ruined by Taylor, a man more than twice Mary's age. And a gun Charlotte owned was a .38. Did the butler do it? Henry Peavy, who was first to discover the body. He had the time and the opportunity, but they couldn't find a motive. Or was it drug-addicted Mabel Norman, one of Hollywood's top comedians? Norman was at Taylor's apartment about the time of the murder, and she was the last known person to see him alive. Edward F. Sands became a prime suspect. Taylor had given Sands, a down-and-out acquaintance from Army days, a job as his houseman. But then Sands stole several $1,000, disappeared, and was never questioned nor apprehended. It all happened over 80 years ago, but amateur sleuths still comb through the facts, the evidence, the hearsay, forever trying to prove who it was, and who it wasn't, that murdered William Desmond Taylor. Down through the years, a persistent dark rumor in Hollywood involves an alleged murder at sea, aboard a 200-foot yacht. The killer, it was believed, was too big to meddle with, and so he got away with it. He had been called a Roman emperor living in the 20th century, William Randolph Hearst, the most powerful media mogul in America. And this man, Thomas Ince, a celebrated movie producer-director, was the one who ended up dead. The yacht, the Oneida, belonged to Hearst. The weekend cruise from Los Angeles to San Diego was to celebrate Ince's 43rd birthday. In addition to the crew and a jazz band, there was an array of Agatha Christie-like characters, including Luella Parsons, before she became the Luella Parsons, making and breaking celebrity careers with her gossip column. At the time, she worked as a movie columnist for Hearst in New York. This was her first trip to Hollywood. Charlie Chaplin, the most famous actor in the world. In addition to his comic brilliance, it was well known that Charlie was quite a ladies' man. Actress Marion Davies, whose star was rising high, due in large part to Hearst, who lavished publicity about her in his newspapers. She was his mistress and the apple of his eye. But the whispers were that another man was nibbling on that apple, namely Charlie Chaplin. So, two powerful men and a beautiful woman, mixed with jealousy, lust, and hate, were the perfect ingredients for an explosion of violence. But then, how did it come about that Thomas Ince was the one who suddenly stopped breathing? The official cause of death reported in the Hearst newspapers was acute indigestion, followed by a heart attack. But according to Charlie Chaplin's secretary, who witnessed Ince being carried off the yacht, there was a bullet hole in his head. He was immediately cremated, and without the body, there was no evidence to contest the heart attack story. It didn't take long for the gossip and rumors to reach the ears of the authorities. The San Diego District Attorney launched an investigation, the sum total of which was the testimony of only one man, a Hearst employee, a Dr. Daniel Goodman. He claimed that Ince had suffered chest pains on the train on their way down from Los Angeles to San Diego, where Ince joined the yacht Party in Progress. He also said that Ince complained that he had had similar attacks before. It was enough for the DA, who considered the case closed. But that didn't stop the rumors. The rumors were saying murder and cover-up. They were saying that Hearst himself was the one who shot Ince, and it was no secret that he kept a gun on board. The favored scenario among skeptics was that Hearst had heard gossip saying that his darling Marion and Charlie were doing the hanky-pank together, so he had invited Charlie along just so he could spy on them and see for himself. And see for himself he did. Marion screamed and Hearst ran off to get his gun. Marion's scream had brought Ince running to see what was happening. He struggled with Hearst for the gun and was thanked for his effort to prevent bloodshed by getting a bullet in his brain. Most people believe that Parsons had witnessed the shooting and that it was no coincidence that shortly after the incident, she signed a lifetime contract with Hearst and became the most powerful gossip columnist in Hollywood history. So whatever happened and however it happened, Charlie Chaplin and Marion Davies were never seen together again. And Charlie faded from the picture. And life went on, as always, in Tinseltown, for everyone except Thomas Ince. Thelma Todd is another mysterious case. She was a popular actress in the 20s and 30s, appearing in over 40 movies, often as the leading lady in the Marx Brothers and Laurel and Hardy movies. On December 16th, 1935, she was found dead in her car, in her garage, dead from carbon monoxide poisoning. She was wearing a mauve and silver evening gown, a mink wrap, and a fortune in jewelry. She had been at a lavish party in her honor at the Trocadero nightclub on Sunset Boulevard. She had come home in the early morning hours. Suicide, according to the police and the coroner. But many believed then, as they do today, that Thelma Todd's death was not a suicide nor an accident, but that she was murdered. The garage was at the top of this long flight of steps, which Thelma either climbed up or was carried up on the last night of her life. She lived with, but was not married to, ex-film director-producer Roland West. Together they owned this place, which at the time was a successful restaurant called Thelma Todd's Sidewalk Cafe. It became a hangout for Hollywood's rich and famous, and also for some unsavory types from the underworld, such as Lucky Luciano. This notorious gangster wanted Thelma to turn part of her cafe into a secret gambling casino. He made her an offer, which she thought she could refuse. So after coming home from the party, about 3:45 in the morning, Thelma's chauffeur offered to walk her up to her door, but she declined. And that was the last time she was seen alive. Why do some think that murder was more likely than suicide? Because Lucky Luciano hated the word no, and because blood was found inside the car and on her. And those close to her said that she was in good spirits and had big plans for the future. Perhaps we'll never know, but Thelma Todd will most likely be remembered not so much for her movies, but for the mysterious circumstances surrounding her death. She was 30 years old. On a cold January morning in Los Angeles, 1947, a woman and her 3-year-old daughter made a shocking discovery in this vacant lot. Close to the sidewalk lay the grisly remains of a young woman, naked and severed completely in half at the waist. She was on her back with her arms raised and her legs wide apart. Her face and body had been deeply slashed with a knife, and there were rope burns on her wrists and ankles. But no blood around the body. The murderer had evidently washed her clean after draining her blood. It was clear to LAPD detectives that she had been killed elsewhere, then dumped here. The cause of death was hemorrhage and shock due to concussion of the brain and lacerations of the face. Who was she? Her face was so badly slashed that the coroner had to sew it together. Her fingerprints were sent to the FBI on the off chance that they would be on file. They were, because of an arrest for underage drinking in Santa Barbara, California. Her name was Elizabeth Short, 22 years old. Elizabeth, or Beth, as she liked to be called, had a very striking look. Her hair was pure black, her skin very white, and she always wore bright red lipstick. She was like a flower, some said, and no one is quite sure when, but at some point, Beth became known as the Black Dahlia. From a small town in Massachusetts, Beth came to Viejo, California, to live with her father when she was 19. But her father kicked her out because he thought she was too messy and too boy crazy. She went to stay with a girlfriend in Santa Barbara, and this is where she and a group of friends were arrested for drunken behavior in a restaurant. She was booked and fingerprinted and ordered to return to Massachusetts, which she did, but she didn't stay long. She came back to California, this time to Hollywood, hoping, as many pretty girls had before and after her, to get into the movies and become a star. From time to time, Beth was sidetracked from her goal with romance. Marriage was another dream, but nothing worked out. She was engaged to a pilot for a time, but he was killed in a crash in India. Then it all came to this. The police had the job of trying to reconstruct her last days and hours to see if it could lead to her killer. The last place she was seen alive was at the Biltmore Hotel, and after this, she was missing for 6 days until she was found in the vacant lot. Eventually, after chasing leads that went nowhere, a prime suspect emerged. A tall, slender man with a pronounced limp. An alcoholic and sex pervert by the name of Jack Wilson. But he died in a fire caused by his own careless smoking before he could be questioned. To this day, however, the case is unsolved, and poor Elizabeth Short will be remembered as the Black Dahlia, the woman that was brutally murdered and cut in half. On June 15th, 1947, a man was reading the Los Angeles Times in the living room of a posh Beverly Hills mansion. It was the end of a long day. Then about 10:30 p.m., his life came to an end, suddenly and very violently. He was Benjamin Siegel, known by the nickname Bugsy, which no one ever called him to his face if they knew what was good for them. Siegel was bad-tempered, a gangster, and a sociopath. He was born in 1906 in Brooklyn. At the age of 14, he ruled his own gang. By 21, he was guilty of mayhem, bootlegging, hijacking, drug dealing, white slavery, burglary, robbery, rape, bookmaking, extortion, and at least 12 murders. Bugsy had ties with other mobsters, such as Meyer Lansky, Lucky Luciano, Frank Costello, Albert Anastasia, and Al Capone. Sometime in the mid-1930s, Bugsy came to Hollywood to run the syndicate's operations on the West Coast. It's been said that Bugsy enjoyed killing, but he could be charming, and he was good-looking. He became a celebrity gangster, a prized guest at Hollywood parties, and he hobnobbed with movie stars such as Cary Grant, Gene Harlow, George Raft, Clark Gable, and Gary Cooper, and many other celebrities. Then in the early 40s, Bugsy was said to have had a vision, one that foresaw the sleepy little gas-stop Nevada town of Las Vegas turning into a gambling paradise. That this was Bugsy's vision has been disputed. The facts are that another man, a Billy Wilkerson, started the construction on the Flamingo Hotel, the first luxury hotel and gambling casino in Las Vegas. But when his money dried up, Bugsy, with $6 million of New York mob money, completed the hotel, and it opened in Hollywood lavish style on New Year's Eve in 1946. A big orchestra and lots of movie stars. Bugsy had seen to every detail, but the grand opening was a flop. This enraged some of the boys in New York, who had already suffered a $5 million overrun on construction costs. Meyer Lansky, one of Bugsy's oldest friends, is most likely the one who signed Bugsy's death warrant. Bugsy must have been feeling good on this June spring night. It was 6 months since the Flamingo's disastrous opening, and now the money was rolling in. He must have felt vindicated, powerful, on top of the world. But there were those who felt it would be a better world without Bugsy, so someone did a professional job of shooting him. The first bullet smashed into his head, knocking one of his eyeballs 15 feet away across the floor. 4 bullets tore into his body, ripping up his lungs and ribs. 4 other bullets missed, but it didn't matter. And whoever did it got away with it. It remains to this day an unsolved murder of one of Hollywood's most notorious celebrities. Johnny Stompanato Jr., a man to put fear into strong men's hearts, an ex-bodyguard to gangster Mickey Cohen. No one ever gave Johnny any guff and got away with it. He knew how to crush his enemies. Yet it was just a 14-year-old girl who offed him, stabbed him in the stomach with a kitchen knife. She was defending her mother, who Stompanato had threatened to kill. The 14-year-old girl was Cheryl Crane, and her mother, one of Hollywood's most glamorous movie stars, Lana Turner. Lana instantly became famous after appearing in a 1937 movie entitled They Won't Forget. In her role, she wore a form-fitting cashmere sweater. She became known as the Sweater Girl. She was just 15 years old. During the Second World War, she became a popular pinup girl for the GIs. After the war, her movie career soared. Her best-known pictures were The Postman Always Rings Twice, released in 1946, and Peyton Place, for which she won an Academy Award in 1958. Her screen persona somewhat paralleled her private life. She married 7 times and had numerous lovers. One of these lovers was Johnny Stompanato Jr. He had pursued her, showered her with gifts and flowers. He was relentless, and it paid off. For a few months, they had a good time together, but the relationship soured, and Lana tried to dump Stompanato, unsuccessfully. Then on April 4th, 1958, in this house in Beverly Hills, the relationship finally came to a sudden end. Cheryl overheard Stompanato threatening to kill her mother. She ran to the kitchen and got a 10-inch butcher knife. She returned to the bedroom where she plunged it into Stompanato's stomach. Or as one theory has it, he simply ran into the knife. At any rate, the knife severed his aorta and he died on the floor. There was an inquest, and after less than an hour, the coroner's jury ruled that it was a justifiable homicide that Cheryl killed to protect her mother. Whatever happened to Alfalfa from the R-Gang comedies, the freckle-faced, squeaky-voiced kid with that irrepressible cowlick? From 1935 to 1942, he was a star, appearing in 60 shorts for Hal Roach. Before he was a teenager, he was on top of his career. But soon his sweet life took a sour turn. His real name was Carl Schweitzer, and the first bad thing that happened was that Carl got too old to play Alfalfa, so Hollywood killed the lights on his career. He barely made a living as a part-time bartender at a tavern in Studio City, and he and a friend by the name of Bud Stiltz hooked up in a bear hunting business. Carl was a sometime guide to such celebrities as Roy Rogers and Henry Fonda. He developed a friendship with them, and they in turn helped him to get a few bit parts. His most promising small part came in 1958 with United Artists, The Defiant Ones, starring Sidney Poitier and Tony Curtis. He hoped his good performance would help resurrect his career. But while he was waiting for the picture's release, things got worse. He became morose and drank heavily. He even had the bad luck of being shot in the arm in a drive-by shooting in front of a bar. To make a few bucks as a hunting guide, he borrowed a dog from his friend Bud Stiltz for an expedition in the woods, but the dog chased after a bear and then ran away. A man found the dog and returned it to the bar Carl was working at, and Carl, relieved to have it back, gave the man $35 as a reward, plus $15 worth of free drinks. On the night of January 21st, 1959, after a drinking bout, Carl and a friend named Jack Piatt decided that Bud Stiltz owed Carl the $50, and they came banging on his door demanding the money. Carl forced his way in, and a fight broke out. Details are sketchy and controversial, but there's no doubt that Stiltz got bashed in the face with a heavy clock. It's also a fact that Stiltz shot Carl with a .38 caliber revolver, and Carl died on the way to the hospital. What is not clear is Stiltz's version of what happened, the main point being that Carl had pulled a knife and was threatening to kill him with it, and that after he shot Carl, Carl closed the knife as he slowly dropped to the floor. Jack Piatt claimed that Carl was not armed, and that Stiltz was a cold-blooded murderer. But the police didn't buy his story, and the killing of Alfalfa over a $50 debt was ruled a justifiable homicide. August 9th, 1969. It was a hot Saturday night in Los Angeles when three young women and a young man, all high on drugs, drove up into the cooler air of the canyons above Beverly Hills. They were on a mission of murder, calculated to start a war between blacks and whites. They called their plan Helter Skelter. Knowing the house they wanted, they turned on to Cielo Drive. It was somewhere around midnight when they pulled up quietly near the house. It took them about 4 hours to complete their grisly work. Between 12:30 and 1 a.m., neighbors heard gunshots. Someone else heard a woman screaming. At 4 a.m., a security patrolman heard several shots. A housekeeper arrived at 8 in the morning and discovered a cut telephone line outside the house. Entering through a back door, she saw blood all over the living room. Looking out the front door, she saw a body on the lawn. She went outside, and in a car parked in the driveway, she found another body, bloody, slumped over on the seat. She ran, screaming hysterically, to the neighbors to call the police. When the LAPD arrived, they found it to be the home of one of Hollywood's top directors, Norman Polanski, and his wife, Sharon Tate. Sharon was 8 months pregnant with their son, who was to be named Paul Richard Polanski. The officers found two bodies on the lawn, one a young man, later identified as Wojtek Frykowski, age 32, a longtime friend of Roman's. He had been shot twice, struck in the head with a blunt instrument 13 times, and stabbed 51 times. The second body, lying about 50 feet away, was that of Abigail Folger, 26, an heiress to the Folger coffee fortune. She and Frykowski had been lovers. She wore a full-length nightgown, which was soaked in blood from 28 stab wounds. As the officers approached the front door, they saw the word pig written in blood. Inside, they found Sharon Tate and a man identified as Jay Sebring. A rope had been tied around their necks and looped up over a rafter, but it wasn't the rope that killed them. Sharon's life ended after 16 stab wounds to her chest and back, which also ended the life of her unborn baby son. Sharon was 26. Jay Sebring, a top hairdresser, whose clients included celebrities such as Frank Sinatra, Paul Newman, and Steve McQueen, had been shot once and stabbed 7 times. The body in the car was identified as 18-year-old Stephen Parent. He had come to visit a friend, a caretaker who lived in the guest house on the estate. Parent died from 4 gunshot wounds. Police determined that a high-standard .22-caliber Longhorn revolver was a single gun used. A 10-year-old boy found it lying on his front lawn 23 days after the killings. Forensics experts also concluded that a single knife or bayonet, such as this one, was used to stab the victims. Everybody had a theory as to who had committed the murders. Even Roman Polanski himself, who had been in Europe at the time, was interrogated at length by the police before being ruled out as a suspect. On August 10th, the night after the murders at the Tate-Polanski estate, the same killers decided that there was more killing to be done. They came down this quiet street, Waverly Drive, just on the edge of Hollywood and Silver Lake. The leader of the group climbed in a back window of the house belonging to Leno and Rosemary LaBianca. The LaBiancas owned a chain of grocery stores, and they had just returned home from a vacation. It was several days before their bodies were discovered. Leno LaBianca had been tied up and had died from multiple stab wounds. A knife and fork were found protruding from his abdomen, and the word war had been carved in his flesh. Rosemary LaBianca had also been tied. She was found lying on the bedroom floor, and she too died from multiple stab wounds. And like the Tate murders, police found words written in blood. On the refrigerator door, the misspelled words helter skelter. On the walls, also scrawled in blood, were death to piggies and rise. Even though the two cases had striking similarities, it wasn't till 3 months later, and after a jailhouse confession, that the police fully realized their connection. By late November, the police finally came up with enough evidence for a grand jury to indict 6 suspects. Charlie Manson, 34, had spent most of his life in juvenile halls and prisons for armed robbery, homosexual rape, Grand Theft Auto, and arson. He was a cult leader, to a band of homeless, drug-addicted youths. He exercised such mind control of his followers that they not only did his bidding like slaves, but murdered for him, and did it with a sense of euphoria. Charles Tex Watson, 23, Manson's right-hand man. Watson was the one using the .22 caliber revolver at the Tate Polanski house. He was high on methamphetamines. He has since indicated that he had no inhibitions as he was killing. At the La Bianca's, after Charles Manson had tied up Leno's and Rosemary's hands behind their backs, Tex stabbed them to death. Patricia Krenwinkel, 21, participated in both the Tate and La Bianca murders. After stabbing Leno LaBianca, she carved the word war on his stomach and left a serving fork stuck in his body. She also smeared the words in blood on the refrigerator and the walls. Susan Atkins, 21, was the one who stabbed Sharon Tate to death, and she claimed to have enjoyed it. When asked why they had committed these murders, she was quoted as saying, "Because we wanted to do a crime that would shock the world, and that the world would have to stand up and take notice." Leslie Van Houten, 19, the youngest of the group, did not participate in the Tate murders, but went with Manson, Krenwinkel, Matson, and Atkins to the LaBiancas. She stabbed Rosemary LaBianca multiple times, but claimed she only did so after Rosemary was already dead. All were convicted of first-degree murder and were sentenced to death. During the trial, Charlie Manson's girls never seemed to take their somber proceedings very seriously. And what was Manson's motive for all the killing? He believed that the English musical group, the Beatles, had sent him hidden messages through their music, urging him to launch Helter Skelter, by which he would begin a race war between blacks and whites. He also believed that he and his followers would be the sole survivors and would rule the world. In 1972, the California Supreme Court abolished the death penalty. And now, 30-some years later, all are in various prisons serving life sentences. Sunset Boulevard, the Strip, is no longer what it used to be. Back in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, it was a glittering highway through Hollywood heaven, a fanfare of glamorous nightclubs. By 1976, its heyday was well over. The stars had left and had turned off most of the lights on their way out. But one star was left behind. He was murdered on the night of February the 12th, here in the garage area of this apartment building. It was about 10 o'clock when several of his neighbors heard him cry out for someone to help him. Three times he screamed, but at that point it was already too late. His name was Sal Mineo, a talented stage and screen actor. He was born in New York, the Bronx, on January the 10th, 1939. His first important role was on stage, appearing with Yul Brynner in The King and I. Sal was the crown prince, and after almost 900 performances, the critics awarded him rave reviews. In 1955, he first stepped in front of a motion picture camera at Warner Brothers. The picture was Rebel Without a Cause, starring James Dean. Sal received an Academy Award nomination for Best Supporting Actor for his portrayal of the character Plato. In that same year came Giant, again with James Dean, and then another Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor in Exodus. In just a few short years, he had become a teen idol, deluged with fan mail, mobbed by teenage girls on the street. He didn't know it yet, but he had reached the zenith of his career and was starting down the slippery slope into near oblivion. He was dubbed an aging teen idol, no longer in demand by the studios. He survived for the next two decades by taking whatever small roles he could find. His last movie role was a bit part in 1971's escaped from the planet of the apes. He was one of the apes, and very few people knew it was him. On the night of his murder, he had been rehearsing, preparing for the LA opening of the play, P.S. Your Cat is Dead. It was a week before opening, and Sal was optimistic that his performance would boost his career for a comeback. But he never got a chance to find out. Someone just walked up to him, maybe to rob him, then stabbed him in the heart. Most likely, Sal put up a fight and lost his life for it. By the time someone got to him, he was lying in the fetal position, gasping for breath. A long stream of blood flowed from his chest. Witnesses said that they saw a white man, between 20 and 30 years of age, running from the crime scene. One witness said that the man had dark hair, while another said blonde. In 1977, over a year after his murder, sheriff's homicide detectives finally found a suspect, a man by the name of Lionel Ray Williams, a black man, not at all matching the descriptions of the witnesses. Williams was not only convicted of Mineo's murder, but also of multiple counts of robbery. To this day, many people believe that while Williams was guilty as charged for the robberies, he was not the one who murdered Sal Mineo. They believe that someone else did, who got away with it. The city of Scottsdale, Arizona, noted for its friendly atmosphere and hospitality, was seemingly a most unlikely place for a grisly murder, especially of a Hollywood star. It happened to Bob Crane, 49, who for 6 years had played the part of Colonel Hogan in the TV show Hogan's Heroes. As to his death, it could be said that he died in his sleep, but he didn't slip away peacefully. Somebody, swinging a blunt instrument, possibly a camera tripod, bashed the whole left side of his head into a bloody mess. Blood was splattered along the entire length of a wall. Also, an electrical cord had been twisted around his neck. He had come to Scottsdale to perform in a play, Beginner's Luck, which was to have run from June 26th to August 5th, 1978. After just a few performances at the Windmill Theater, Bob Crane's career was over forever. With his murder, Crane's private life became a public scandal. The humorous, quick-witted character he had played in Hogan's Heroes gave no hint of his dark side in real life. In the apartment where he was killed, number 132A of the Winfield Apartments, police found video equipment and hundreds of tapes and pictures of him having sex with women, sometimes with multiple partners. Some of the women were married and didn't know that their indiscretions were being recorded for posterity. So who killed him? Theories at the time were not in short supply, ranging from a mafia hit to him being done in by some woman's jealous husband or boyfriend. He once said about his sexploits, "Eventually, you'll find out there's a husband of theirs out there. I think all single people should have a card verified by the Pope that they're single, so you don't wake up someday and find a gun to your head because you didn't hear the footsteps." But the unheard footsteps, the police were convinced, weren't made by a jealous husband, but by this man, John Carpenter. He had been a close friend, and the two had socialized and chased women together. While Carpenter, usually glad to accept whatever leftovers his celebrity buddy couldn't handle. Finding a bit of blood in Carpenter's rental car, the police theorized that he killed Crane because their friendship was ending. It wasn't until 1992, 14 years after the murder, that he was arrested and brought to trial. But the jury let him walk because of insufficient evidence. He died of a heart attack in 1998 at the age of 70. Dorothy Stratten, no mystery nor controversy about her death. She had half her head blown off with a shotgun. She was only 20. Her estranged husband, Paul Snyder, was the one who shot her, and then about a half hour later, he shot himself. It happened here in this apartment in 1980, sometime in the afternoon on August 14th. It was about 11 o'clock that night before their bodies were discovered. Who was Dorothy Stratten, and why did her murder cause such a storm of gossip and scandal in Hollywood? She grew up in a small community just outside Vancouver in British Columbia. She went to high school there. At 17, she was quiet, modest, friendly, and very much a beauty. She took a part-time job at this Dairy Queen, and it was here that she met Paul Snyder, a small-time hustler who saw Dorothy's beautiful face and body as his golden key to a fortune. He took pictures of her, even talked her into posing nude for him, and he sent them off to Playboy magazine. She became a playmate, and about a year later, she was named Playmate of the Year. She even took up residence in the Playboy mansion. Paul convinced her that it was in her best interest to get married, and so they tied the knot in Las Vegas. She began acting and appeared in two films, Skate Town, USA, and Autumn Born. Then at a party, Paul introduced her to this man, director Peter Bogdanovich. He cast her in his movie. They all laughed. And by the end of production, she and Peter were in love. So she left Paul and moved in with Peter. Paul was jealous and outraged. He hired a detective to spy on her. Dorothy agreed to meet Paul at their old apartment in L.A. She brought $1,000 to salve Paul's wounded feelings and to talk about their divorce. She was going to marry Bogdanovich. No one knows much about what happened during their meeting, but everyone knows for sure that Paul put a shotgun to her head and pulled the trigger. Then he killed himself. This is the story of a family, the Menendezes. Some thought them the perfect family, until a warm summer night in 1989, when two 12-gauge shotguns blew it apart. Jose Menendez, 45, husband and father. At 16, he came to the United States from Havana. He got a CPA degree and fought his way up in the business world, and ended up as president of Live Entertainment. He liked to be called Joe rather than Jose. Kitty Menendez, 48, wife and mother. Before she met and married Jose, she dreamed of producing and directing radio and television programs, but she gave up her dream in favor of supporting Jose and his career. And two sons, Lyle, 25, and Eric, 22. The brothers were close, best friends. They enjoyed the perks of a wealthy Beverly Hills family, and both were fiercely competitive tennis players. Lyle attended Princeton, and Eric went to UCLA. They lived in a dream home mansion, formerly lived in by Michael Jackson, Prince, and Elton John. From nothing, Jose and Kitty had built a $14 million estate, and their boys had a big head start to a bright future. Then on the night of August 20th, 1989, at 11:47 p.m., a 911 call came into the Beverly Hills Police Department. It was Lyle Menendez, frantic and sobbing. The dispatcher finally understood that he and his brother had come home and found their parents had been shot to death. When police arrived, Lyle and Eric were crying, falling onto their knees, apparently traumatized. They shouted over and over that they couldn't believe what had happened. They were taken to the police department, not as suspects, but the police thought they might know something that would help in the investigation, but neither offered any information of value. When asked who might have wanted their parents dead, Lyle said, maybe the mob. The autopsy results on Jose and Kitty could have suggested a mob hit, an emotional one. Both had been shot numerous times with implications that the shooter or shooters had emptied their shotguns and then reloaded to keep on firing. Lyle and Eric spared no expense for their parents' memorial service at the Directors Guild of America in Hollywood. When they arrived, Eric appeared to be an emotional mess. Lyle seemed to be in control, holding up quite well. Just a few days after the murders, the brothers went on a spending spree, financed with over $600,000 from Jose's life insurance policy. They bought Rolex watches, jewelry, stereo equipment, and designer clothes. Lyle bought a Porsche 911 Carrera, and Eric got a Jeep Wrangler. They moved out of their Beverly Hills mansion and moved from one luxury hotel to another. Here at the Bel Air Hotel, they ran up a bill of nearly $9,000 in just 5 days. They rented two apartments in Marina City Towers and made a down payment on a $1 million penthouse. Lyle decided to go into business in a big way. He sank money into a new venture in Princeton called Menendez Investment Enterprises. It never opened for business. He bought a restaurant in Princeton for $550,000, and that didn't work out either. Eric tried to sponsor a rock concert. He invested $40,000. A partner was to have invested another $40,000, but the partner disappeared into thin air with Eric's money. Eric then decided to quit UCLA and become a tennis pro. He hired a coach for $5,000 a month. Meanwhile, the police were finding out that the Menendez's reputation for being the perfect family was somewhat flawed. Jose had enemies. He had crushed a lot of opposition on his way to the top. He was hated by a number of colleagues and subordinates, some of which became suspects. Then there was a break in the case. Police learned that Eric's psychotherapist had audio tapes of the brothers admitting to the murders. Lyle had threatened the psychotherapist's life if he told anyone. And the fact that Lyle and Eric had spent $1 million in just 4 months since the murders made them the prime suspects. Lyle was arrested in front of the Mendez mansion as he and two friends were leaving to have lunch at a Beverly Hills restaurant. 3 days later, Eric, who had been in Israel for a tennis tournament, was arrested and taken into custody at the Los Angeles International Airport. The police were certain now that the brothers had been the killers, and the motive, according to the district attorney, was greed. On July 20th, 1993, the brothers were brought to trial. The defense conceded that they had indeed murdered their parents, but that they had been both sexually and mentally abused since the time they were children, and that they were in fear of their lives when the killings took place. The jury deadlocked, and the judge declared a mistrial. In a second trial, Lyle and Eric were found guilty and sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. Today, Lyle is a janitor at the California Corrections Institution. Eric works as a groundskeeper at the California State Prison. It was 10:55 on a Sunday night, June 12, 1994, when a resident of this street, South Bundy Drive in Brentwood, tried to find out why a neighbor's dog was so agitated, continually howling and barking in a plaintive manner. He saw that the dog, an Akita, was loose on the sidewalk and that its belly fur and paws were covered with blood. But it wouldn't be quieted. 10 minutes after midnight, the dog led the neighbors to the owner's gate, and they discovered an horrific scene. One described seeing blood flowing down the walk like a river. It came from the body of 35-year-old Nicole Brown Simpson. Her killer had slashed her neck with a knife, almost severing her head from her body. Her body lay 15 feet from the front entrance. The murderer's bloody footprints could be seen on the walk. There was another body, a man crumpled up and lying a few feet away, obscured by bushes. Near the dead man was a number of objects, among them a blood-stained leather glove and a blood-spattered white envelope. Nicole was the ex-wife of O.J. Simpson, a former football star. After his football days were over, he became a sports announcer, a spokesman for Hertz Rental Car Agency, and a part-time actor. Police determined that the second body was that of Ronald Goldman, 25, a friend of Nicole's, a waiter, a part-time model, and an aspiring actor. He had been stabbed multiple times. Just a few blocks away from where he died, Ron had waited on tables here at the Mezzaluna restaurant. Earlier in the evening of the murders, Nicole, with a group of nine others, had dinner here from 6:30 to 8:30. At 9:35, Ron got a call from Nicole. She had left behind a pair of sunglasses. Ron agreed to drop them off. He left the restaurant at 9:50 p.m. It was between 9:50 and 10:15, sometime between these 25 minutes, that Nicole and Ron were murdered. For it was 10:15 when Nicole's neighbor first heard her Akita dog howling. The dog would turn out to be the sole witness to the savage killings. At 4:30 a.m. Monday morning, the police came to O.J. Simpson's estate to notify him of the murders. His white Ford Bronco was parked outside. They saw a blood stain on it near the handle of the driver's side. They also saw blood leading to the house, and a bloody glove matching the one at the murder scene was found. According to a witness staying in a guest house on the estate, Simpson had left in a limousine at 11:15 p.m. the night before to go to the airport for an 11:45 flight to Chicago. Later, it was established that he checked in at the O'Hare Plaza Hotel at 4:15 a.m. the following morning. Police contacted Simpson in Chicago, and he returned to Los Angeles. At this point, he had become the prime suspect, and shortly after he arrived home at 11:08 a.m., the police took him to LAPD headquarters and questioned him for 3.5 hours. Finally, he was released without being charged. A search warrant for Simpson's estate was issued, and inside the house, the police found bloodstained socks. DNA tests on the socks and glove showed that the blood was a mixture of both victims, as well as Simpson's. This, along with other evidence, was enough to convince the police that O.J. Simpson was indeed the killer. On Friday, June 17th, police ordered Simpson's attorney to bring O.J. to police headquarters to surrender. But he became a fugitive, and in a white Ford Bronco belonging to Al Cowling, an old football buddy, he and Cowling led police on a bizarre 40-mile-an-hour chase on the L.A. freeways. It was the most watched, spontaneous event in television history. Eventually, Simpson returned to his estate and was arrested and taken into custody. He was charged with 2 counts of murder with special circumstances, which made him eligible for the death penalty. People of the State of California, Plaintiff versus Orenthal James Simpson, Defendant, Case Number BA097211, was how the trial began on January 23, 1995. In their opening statements the following day, the prosecutors laid their case before the jury, saying that Simpson couldn't face his life without Nicole. After their divorce, she had had relationships with other men, and since he could no longer control her, he decided to kill her. As to Ronald Goldman, it was a case of him simply being in the wrong place at the wrong time. And he had to be killed as well. The central theme of the defense was that this case was a rush to judgment, an obsession to win at any cost. O.J. had indeed accepted the end of his marriage, and he was nowhere near 875 South Bundy at the time of the murders. The trial was to last almost 9 months, and the media called it the trial of the century. To most observers, it seemed to be an open and shut case against Simpson. The jury returned with a verdict in just 4 hours. An estimated 90% of all people watching television were tuned in to hear the verdict. And what they heard was not guilty. And O.J. Simpson walked out of the courtroom a free man. Thank you.